דניאל בן יעל. אוסו להצלחת אסתר קלי בת חנה, שתצא מהגוי. ג'ואן בת חנה, יעקב בן שמעון, חנה בת סעדה, שמעון בן אסתר, צבי בן משה אלי, לעילוי נשמת צבי בן משה אלי, יוסף בן דורין, לרפואת הנפש, רפואת הגוף, ולעילוי נשמת אינה צירל בת זליג. And all the other ones who need רפואה, the list is growing by the seconds. You have to be blind and a complete fool not to realize that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is furious about the world and especially about us. Because the world is us. We are the diamond of the world. Everything was made, Hashem said, for Israel. There's no Israel in the world. I don't need this world. What do I need this for? All the tragedies that the Goyim has, besides the fact that Hashem is punishing them for all their sins, mainly, the main reasons for that is for the nation of Israel to see what happened to them and to wake up. Which means, sometimes we are nothing better. It should have been to us. Hashem with His mercy gives us another warning and another warning. When a person drives like crazy and he sees an accident and another accident, it's supposed to remind him to slow down, to calm down, right? Accident scares a person. Wow, that could have been me, God forbid. They see an ambulance picking up somebody from the floor. It makes him scared. Just reviewing what's happening in Europe and in the United States and in other countries, it's showing that time is running out. No doubt, time is running out. Last week I told you about Europe is going bankrupt slowly, slowly. Now it's much faster now. Did you hear what happened today in Greece? There's a riots already. 100,000 Greek people on the streets burning things. They burn a bank. 3 people died today. The police are fighting against them. It's tomorrow it can be 300,000, and next week it can be 2 million, and the whole country will collapse to pieces. And then it goes to Portugal, and then to Spain. Who knows what can happen? And you know, one thing connects to the other, because you cannot say, oh, what do we care about this? It's Spain, it's in Portugal. No. It's going to affect us, it's going to affect Israel. Already the Israeli flower market is dead. Because most of this month you couldn't fly out of Europe. You couldn't fly to Europe, and all the flyers got spoiled. That's it. They lost who knows how many millions of dollars. All season they wait for this summer time that they ship all their millions of flowers to Europe or to the United States, whatever, and they all get stuck in the end and they lose their whole year. Big problems. Also, I heard that the volcano again today explode again. They close again the airport today in some places. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu is angry. Angry at the descendants of Esav, angry on the Amalekim, angry at them. In the United States, Hashem sends a warning. A bomb in Times Square could have killed hundreds of people or thousands, who knows. The miracle happened. He didn't know, the Arab didn't know how to set the bomb correctly. It happens a lot in Israel. They make the bombs to kill themselves. It happens a lot. Every month you hear an accident. Engineer blew himself up. You know? The same thing with Haman. Haman made a tree for Mordechai. And in the end it was for him and for his sons. So, we don't really know what's going to happen. We don't know. One thing leads to another. The president of Iran was in the United States for probably the 4th times. And for whatever reason, nobody touched him. If an Israeli president would be in Iran, I'm sure he wouldn't come out alive. They'll set up something, an accident, something they'll set up. You know, but over here, in the name of the democracy, the new Adolf Hitler is coming in and out like a king. And they supply him with security, and we pay the taxes for it. We pay for all these FBI and all these people who watch him. just to think that the money, the tax, the American nation is paying taxes to protect this new Hitler. One day they will cry for it, that's for sure. People wake up when it's too late sometimes. So anyway, what is in it for us? First of all, it brings me great joy to see so many young guys coming to hear Shiurei Torah. And this generation, Baruch Hashem, everywhere you go, the youth waking up finally. Even though when a person is younger than 20, his intelligence is not set correctly yet, and is immature. Even you can be more mature than average, but up to 20, still we are learning what life is all about. Baruch Hashem, now we see 16, 17, ages that it used to be impossible to talk to people, now they open to ear. And that's a part of the prophecy of Hashem. I'm going to put hunger in a land, not hunger for food. Food, you have plenty. Look how much food in the world. They throw tons of food every day to the ocean because it's too much. Not to break the market, the prices. They throw vegetables, fruits, so much. And it's enough that you go to one wedding, especially Bukharian. It's enough to feed the entire United States for 5 years. So Baruch Hashem, we're not hungry for food. Maybe some people don't have enough to put gas in their Mercedes, but for food, there's plenty of food. So what's the hunger? The prophet said, the hunger to hear the word of Hashem all over the world. Everybody. Spirituality all of a sudden. Everywhere you go. Yeah, I have to go soon to Belgium. Now they send me an email from Germany. This weekend I was in Canada. Now in Istanbul, Turkey, I'm afraid to go there. And I have to put a custom over there, you know, especially now. But still, you see Jews everywhere. Jews everywhere. And some of them leave their work. They go to Yerushalayim, they go to seminars, they go to yeshiva for a month. Psh. Very impressive. I encourage every Jew that wants to make tshuva and become a tzaddik, wants to become righteous, you have to know, it will never be the same if you started with a month or two in a yeshiva, full day, or you started on your own just coming to shul an hour or two here and there. No, it will never be the same. It will never be the same. If you go, if you take a time out from whatever you do, school, in between semesters, whatever, summer vacation, or if you're working, you take a time out, I promise you, the 2 months that you learn constantly, full day, it will be like years learning an hour or 2 hours a day, like years. And it's going to give you a really good push. We'll show you what life of Torah is. What does it mean to be a Jew? How much is the importance of the Torah? It's very important. You know, people never forget to eat, right? You don't eat for 6 hours, you need to eat. The body reminds you. The problem is that there's nothing that reminds us that we didn't learn enough Torah today. You cannot learn Torah 70 years. Nobody says, excuse me, you didn't learn today. The Gemara says, the Torah... Every day there is an echo, there's an announcement in heaven. HaKadosh Baruch Hu say, Oy labriot me'elbona shel Torah. Oy to the public. It's talking about the Jews, because the Jews are obligated to learn Torah. They are obligated, especially the men. Oy labriot me'elbona shel Torah. Oy to the public from embarrassing my Torah. How you embarrass the Torah? Chas v'shalom, every Jew kiss the Torah and hug the Torah, right? When you saw all the secular Jews, when they come to shul, the first thing they go is they go to the parochet for about 20 minutes. They go like this, like the Western Wall. They kiss, they hug, everything is fine. So why? Who's embarrassing the Torah? No, nobody's embarrassing the Torah. I bet you if you take the Torah now on the street and you walk here in Main Street, all the secular Jews and some goyim will come to kiss the Torah. So why HaKadosh Baruch Hu is complaining? He said that we're embarrassing his Torah. So it's we're humiliating the Torah in a way. How? By not learning it is the biggest insult. It's the biggest insult. What is it like? The best speaker in the world come to a place to speak and nobody shows up. Nobody intended to embarrass him. Nobody threw eggs at him. Nobody came to demonstrate against him. No. They just didn't show up. They did nothing. They sat in their house and didn't show up. That's the biggest insult for him. He comes to a place, they put flyers, whatever, nobody shows up. It's like the Torah. The Torah is on the shelf almost in every Jewish house. and go check from all the books in the library which one has the most dust on top of it. When you take it out of the shelf, right? You take it out of the shelf, I promise you, the one with most of the dust is right there, the Torah. Moby Dick, War and Peace, Dictionary, New York Times, everything doesn't have dust, all the nonsense. The Torah has a lot of dust. That's an insult. An echo comes from heaven, Hashem say, Oy la briot me'elbona shel Torah. Torah munachat bekeren zavit. The Torah is thrown in a corner of the room and nobody runs to pick it up. This is all expressions to wake us up. Baruch Hashem, no, there is a future when the young generation waking up, the prophet says that the children will bring back their parents. Children will bring back their parents into the Torah, and this is exactly what happened in our time. The Torah says, En divrei Torah mitkaynim, Ela b'mi shememit atzmo aleihem. Translation, words of Torah cannot remain in the head of a person unless if he kill himself for it. Memit atzmo. How can you kill yourself for it? How can you kill yourself? So the simple understanding is, I learn until I collapse. That's it. All my energy went for the learning. I cannot get up from the chair. My cousin in Israel, when he learns, he can't get up from the chair when he finishes the day. He can't sit. He cannot get up. Why? Thinking with the brain deeply for hours is much more tiring than being a mover or running a marathon. Much more tiring. Because the brain, it's the computer of the body. Everything that you feel in your body comes from the brain. Pain, exhaustion, allergies, you're tired, depression, or happiness, sadness, whatever you have, it's all from the brain. Some people in this, there are 2% of the people in the world. I think that's the percentage. Don't catch me on that, but that's what somebody told me. 2% of the people in the world suffer from a disease that's called manic depression, bipolar. Manic depression, which means there's problems in their brain with the chemicals. The brain releases chemicals all the time. And they don't have a balance there. Sometimes it's too much, sometimes it's too little. So I guess when it's too much, they make them very happy and very hyper. And all of a sudden it drops. And they collapse like this, they can hardly move. And they become very depressed. And it's very, it's an amazing thing. Some of them, They take very heavy medication. The medication makes them even more down. They can hardly open their eyes. And they're very slow with the medication. And they don't like to take the medication. And after a while, they say, now I feel better. And then they get an attack and they become very dangerous. They can drive like crazy, hit cars. And they handcuffs them and they put them inside, behind bars in a special hospital for 2, 3, 4 weeks. And every week almost I find new Jews that have it. Not only Jews, all over the world people has it. It's just showing you when one little thing's happening in the brain, we're not talking massive chemical, we're not talking a spoon of sugar here. Very, very little. That's it, the whole body cannot function. Cannot function. For what? For one drop of powder somewhere in the brain. I don't know exactly how it works, but this is it. It finishes you. So the brain is everything. So Hashem says, how the Torah will remain by you, you will never forget it even after 70 years, what you learned today, by putting all your energy 100%. That's the simple meaning. But there's a secret in it. What does it mean, Mishem Memit Atzmo Aleha? There are two kinds of learners in the yeshivot and in the shuls and anywhere that people learn Torah. Two kinds of learners. Serious one and jokers. Two ones. Same thing in every school. Not only in yeshiva. In public school you also have serious students and jokers that just come to warm the chair. Yeah? So in yeshiva it's much more critical than any school or history or any or math or anything that you learn. Why? Because the Torah has different studies than any other studies you know. Any other studies, the more hours you learn, the more you'll know. You learn 1 hour math, You learn 2 hours, you most likely will know double, because you learn 2 hours instead of 1 hour today. By the Torah, it's a snowball. You learn the first hour, you learn very little. The second hour, you learn a little more than the first hour. The third hour, you learn a little more. That means after 20 years, every hour that you learn, it's much more productive than the first hour you learned 20 years ago. It could be that 20 years later, 1 hour can be like a month of a beginner. It's because it's something, it's spiritual, it's not physical. Physical, it's 1 and 2 and 3 and 5, that's how it goes. Over there with the Torah, it's gifts. How much Hashem wants to put in your head based on your efforts. Nowhere in the world you get reward based on your efforts. If you learn 20 hours for your math test and you fail, you still get 40. That's it. 40 out of 100, you fail. You need to go and take another test. In the Torah, if you learn and you didn't understand, you get a huge reward for the efforts. So it's a no-lose situation. You only win. You always win. You can be sleeping inside the yeshiva even. Let's say you fell asleep and still earn. Why? Better to sleep there, even though it's not allowed lechatchila to fall asleep in a yeshiva or in a synagogue. But let's say a person is very tired, he fell asleep, he can't control it. Just the fact that he's there for an hour and two and people talk divrei Torah, it's very good. Why? He sleep at home, he hear lousy television, it's worse. It goes into the soul. A person that slept in a bad place and heard cursing and bad talking, when you wake him up, you hypnotize him, he will tell you everything that people were talking there the whole day. Everything. So you see that you can be sleeping and making scenes, not intentionally, by listening to all this nonsense and garbage that people are talking about. So obviously it's better. I remember when I came to yeshiva, in my first days, I had a rav, big tzaddik, he's still, Baruch Hashem, still there in Monsi, Rabbi Rosenman, his name. He loves the Torah so much that even when he walks in the street, he walks with a walkman. Why? He doesn't have a car, so he walks with a very heavy bag full of books. And he walks for miles sometimes. He walks half a mile, another mile. He walks. So he has this walkman. While he's walking, he's listening to Torah, not to waste time. So one time I came to the shiur, there were 3 students learning with him. One was sick that day, didn't show up. I was late a few minutes, and the one that is there, his head is down on a table and he's sleeping, and I come and I see the Rav is talking. As usual, he has the Gemara open. Amar Abaye, Amar Rava, what's the Kushiya? How is it possible? I'm watching him. So who is he talking to? One guy is missing, one guy is sleeping. So I come to him, I say, Kvod Rav, don't you see he's sleeping? I thought maybe he's in the Gemara, I didn't pay attention. He said, no, no, don't worry, soul is hearing everything. He's listening. You live the truth. You live by it. Not only, oh, yeah, I know. You live according to it. It changed you completely. So anyway, so what does it mean, en devre Torah mitkaimim ela b'mi shemimit atzmo aleim? What does it mean, the Torah cannot remain unless if you kill yourself over it, which means, when you enter the yeshiva, I'm dead. For the world, I'm not here. When a person died, can you call his cell? Somebody who died this morning. You're going to call him at 4 in the afternoon? You won't call him, right? Because you know nobody will answer. Once a person enters the yeshiva, if he's serious, for him the world does not exist. I'm not here. Don't look for me. What happens if there's going to be something in the store? We have to call you. There's something happening. You're the owner of the store. No, I'm not. I don't exist. What happens if the store goes on fire? Don't call. Don't bother me. I'm dead for 2 hours or 3 hours. I'm not here. That's called memit atzmo alem. When I'm learning, I'm dead. For the world, I'm dead. My soul is alive, but my body is dead. I cannot hear anything. I cannot see anything besides the Torah. People who behave like this when they come to learn, they achieve a lot more than people who come in and out. Cigarette break, coffee break, telephone. Oh, that's emergency, Rabbi. That's emergency. That's in yeshiva. I have worse than this. I see people in the middle of the lecture get a phone call and starting to talk. In front of everybody. Huh? Yeah. Make a right. Go 5 blocks. In the middle of the lecture. This is what the Gemara says. Listen. The Gemara says, that two of the great rabbis were sitting and asking about the Torah of Tinokot Shel Bet Rabban, the kids that learns Torah. So they said, the world exists thanks to the pure Torah that comes out of the children's mouth. Why? Because they're still not bar mitzvah. So even if they make sins, it's not registered to their soul, to their file. If a kid makes a sin, even if a kid stole, let's say 6 years old and he stole, it's a very bad sin, but when he become older, he's not guilty of what he did when he was 6 years ago, when he was 6 years old, because he's still innocent. Up to 13, he's innocent. So it's very interesting, because these kids, even if they make sins, the soul stay pure. Did you ever realize, did you ever wonder why we love the baby so much? Like, you're crazy about the baby. You want to hug them all the time. You want to kiss them. You want to see them. You will just leave the house. You want to go back to see your little baby. But you don't miss your older kids like this. If you have a 16, 17 years old kid, especially if he became a cushy walking like this with his jeans down, you don't want to see him for a month already. You're disgusted by him, the way some of the kids behave today. But I'm even talking a tzaddik kid, goes to learn, very nice, nice boy. When you see him, you don't feel like running and hugging him and kissing him. Oh, I missed you so much. Mwah, 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 mwah. Pick him up like a baby. You go crazy when you see the babies. See all the time. Why is it? What makes the babies cute that we love them so much? Even an ugly baby. Still love him. A very ugly baby. Still love him. Doesn't matter, you still feel like you want to, you know, you have special love to him. The answer is, the younger they are, the soul is more pure. Your soul is anxious to connect with his soul. That's the secret. When people become older, they're full of sins, the soul. There's no desires anymore between one soul to another. When they're not like this, they're very pure. The sin doesn't stick. It's very interesting. I mean, I'm telling you, the soul is pure 100%, especially in the bone. It's 100%. The Gemara says like this. The Gaon, Rav Yechezkel Landa, he has a nickname, it's called Hanoda Be'Yehuda. Very big tzaddik. I think it was 200 years ago. Shama yelet boche bachutz. He heard a kid crying outside of his window. While he was learning Torah, he heard a kid crying outside. He goes out. A person that has a heart cannot ignore the crying of any person, especially a kid, no? So he goes out. It was a little raining and a cold day. And he comes to the boy and he says, can I help you? Something happened. There was a Christian boy, a goy. So the goy, he looks at the rabbi that came out, and he says, you see, my mother died, and my father got remarried to a very cruel woman. And she's torturing me every day. We have a bakery, the family. We bake breads. And she makes me go from early in the morning until very late at night. All day I have to go sell the breads. She made me a slave. I don't learn. I don't have my own life, no friends, no nothing. From the moment I wake up, all day I walk in the street, summer, winter, to sell breads. But today, I sold all the breads, and I was on my way home, and I checked my pocket, and I saw that all the money fell somehow. I lost all my money. And it's 20 dinars. 20 dinars. And if I go home now, she'll kill me. I'm going to get beaten up so much just for losing the money. I'm afraid to go home. And I'm freezing here. I don't know what to do. We felt very bad for him. So he told him, don't worry, wait here. He went inside. He got 25 dinars. He gave him 20 dinars. He said, this is for your stepmother. And here is 5 more for you. Go buy yourself a hot meal. Eat, relax a little bit. Don't worry. Nothing happened. So he was very happy, hugged him, thank you, Rabbi, I appreciate it, and he left. That was the story. 30 years later, 30 years is a long time. 30 years later, somebody knocks on his door. He opened the door, This is Chol HaMoed of Pesach. In the middle of Pesach, a goy, 45 years old, something like that, knock on the door. Hello, can I help you? Of the rabbi, the Noda Biyuda, now he's an old man already, 30 years later. He knocks on his door, Shalom Rabbi, hello. You probably don't remember me, but 30 years ago right here on this rock, you saved my life, I came, I was a kid, you gave me money, I lost my money, I was selling breads. So now my parents died and I own the bakery. And there's a group of bakers, it's a union. And now the priest of this town is very big anti-Semite. He called all the bakers to a meeting. Nobody knew what is it about. The meeting just over a few hours ago, and the priest ordered, everyone is afraid of him, you know, because in the old days the church used to be like the court. They used to be in charge of everything. Today, especially in America, they separated between religion and civil courts and criminal courts. It's two different institutions. But that's how it was. They used to be everything. So he told him, the priest made an order to all the bakers to put poison in the bread that they baked in Motzei Pesach. When Pesach is over, the Jews don't have flour, they don't have everything to bake at home. So they all go to buy from the bakeries of the Goyim. It's called Pat Paltar. It's allowed in certain situations. So now all the town will die this Motzei Pesach. So since you saved me and you helped me so much, I want now to pay you back. And now I didn't have a chance to pay you all these years. I'm telling you this secret. So he went into the court, into the shul, and Pesach. Everybody comes to shul in Yom Tov. And he announced, no one is allowed to buy from the Goyim, Motzei Pesach, anything. No bread, no muffins, no cakes, nothing. And he made cherem. He says, somebody who will buy a bread, he made them so scared that nobody will dare to do it. It will be the end of him in his community. We isolate him, we put a band on him. He's finished. He cannot be in a community, not in a school. He made them so scared. Oh, what happened? To buy bread from the goy? It's all you, Rabbi. What's the problem? No, no, no. This week, you don't go to the bakery over there at all. And they made thousands of breads. And they couldn't believe. They're all waiting. You know, usually, you know, Motzei Pesach, the stores that sell chametz are booming. You know, look at all the pizza stores. The owner of the pizza store, 8 days counting the minutes for the greatest night of the year. They freeze tons of dough, you know, everything is ready just for that moment. The Goyim prepared so much, not only they didn't kill any Jew, they lost fortune, you know, all the work, the labor. So you see, that's called the Gemara says, actually it's in Kohelet, Shlach lachmecha al hamayim. What does it mean, Shlach lachmecha al hamayim? It's like you're throwing your hook to catch the fish, you're throwing a net. You don't know what's going to come out. Something will come out one day. So it's an expression. What's the expression? The expression is, Shlach lachmecha al pnei hamayim, ki berov hayamim timtzaenu. You plant the seeds today, one day you'll get the fruit. Don't worry. Sooner or later, the fruits will come out. It's in Midrash Rabba Kohelet, Yud Aleph. Rabbi Elazar ben Shamoa is one of the Tanaim in the time of the Gemara. Halach liat Sfat Hayam Agadol. He was walking by the beach. In the old days, you could walk by the beach. Today, it's a life risk. Cannot walk by the beach today. A kosher Jew cannot even come near her. It's hell in this life. 1 hour walking on the beach, who knows how many years you have to make tshuva. They're calling, they close the beach, don't worry. It's okay. They heard the announcement. So Baruch Hashem, in the old days when somebody went to the beach, nobody dared to come the way they are today, obviously. Even the Goyim, they didn't allow themselves to dress like this. So Rabbi Elazar ben Shamoa alach liat Sfat Hayam. He went by the beach. He looked on the water and he saw a boat is sinking. A boat sinking in the water. And he sees all these goyim jump from the top, from the bottom. They swim, they try to get saved. Some of them are drowning. And some of them are holding pieces of wood and try to swim to the beach. So one goy, maybe he was in a shower when it happens, maybe he was sleeping, but he was completely naked. He's in the water now. Now he wants to come out to the beach, but there's people there. So he starts to scream, "Excuse me, anybody can lend me a coat or something that I can get dressed?" Nobody pays attention to him. They ignore him. He screams for an hour, "Excuse me, sir, sir, sir." He's deaf today. Today he's deaf. Nobody gives him a coat. He's getting tired. How long he can swim like this without drowning? All of a sudden, Rabbi Elazar ben Shamua passed by. He hears that this guy screams, "Excuse me, excuse me." Right away he took his long coat. And he said, come here to the corner. Here, take the coat. I gave him the coat. He saved him. Now he can come out. He can go and buy himself something. But he doesn't have any money. Everything that he had is drowning. So he said, "Okay, wait a minute. Come with me to my house. Let me make you a good meal that you relax, you drink. I'll give you some money. Like this, I'll help you out to start." So he took him to his home. And, you know, once he relaxed, he rested, he gave him, you know, some more clothes to wear. He gave him enough money. 200 dinar he gave him. It's like $200 today, let's say. He doesn't know him, Bichlal. Just saw him drowning. He gave him a meal, he gave him a coat, and he gave him $200. No, to start until you get to where you have to go. Many years later, the Caesar died. This is the time when the Romans were in control of Israel. So the Caesar died. The Caesar Romai, the Caesar, the king, died. And who became the new Caesar? That guy. It was an important guy. He didn't know. Then when he saved him, it was already important. Now he became the king instead of the Caesar. First thing he did when he became the king, the entire city where I almost drowned will be executed in a week. Everybody. I don't leave one person alive there. He sends them letters to prepare. They have 1 week. We're coming and killing everybody. Real revenge. So right away, everybody went crazy. "Wow, what happened? Why we didn't give him a coat?" What? They already realized. So somebody remembered, "Wait a minute, there was that rabbi that gave him a coat. Let's find that rabbi." Started to ask around, "You remember who he was?" Say, yeah, his name is Rabbi Elazar ben Shamua. He sits in this yeshiva. They ran over there, the entire city, they come to him. They collected money, 4,000 coins of gold. A lot of money. It's like $400,000 today. They collected a lot of money and they brought him a big bag with coins of gold. And they say, "Rabbi, you're the only one who can save life here. He wants to kill the entire city. Please go to him after you saved him. He will probably listen to you. Tell him that this 4,000 coins of gold is a kapara. We make tshuva, repentance for what we did to him. He's right. We're sorry, and this is our gift to him." So he takes all the money and he went to him. He comes inside. They allow him to go in. He didn't recognize him. It's many years. So he told him, "Remember me?" So as soon as he started to see, he said, "Oh yeah, you're the one who took me to your home. You gave me 200 dinar. You gave me your coat. Sure, come in, Rabbi, sit." And he said, what can I do for you?" So he told him, "I came to ask forgiveness for this city. You know, you're right. They made a sin. They should have saved you. But they made a mistake. But they didn't really mean. It was nothing personal. Forgive them. Here, they brought 4,000 coins of gold, much more money. And, you know, you take the money and leave them alone." So he said, "Okay, for your honor, I won't kill them. But you can keep the money. The 4,000 coins of gold, it's yours." And then he said, "Come with me." He took him to a room. There was 170 suits in the entire room. But you know, it's not suits like today, all machine make, one after the other. Over there in the suit, in the old days, used to be custom. Handmade. Very expensive, silk, handmade. 170 suits for the king. Imagine how much it was. It's like thousands of dollars each suit. He told him, take all the suits. I have my servant, take them, sell them, make business, do whatever you want. He made him rich. The quote he gave the goy, first of all, saved thousands of people from death. And in the end, one day, that's called Shlach Lachmecha Al Amayim. Have patience. You should know one thing. Sometimes we think, okay, I'm going to be smart. I'll plant the seeds in the right places. Like this, for sure, one day it will bring me some pleasure or help. For instance, my friend is a politician. I know it's just a matter of time that one day will be, I don't know, a minister or prime minister. It's already in the Knesset. Another 5-6 years, he's going to be in charge of budgets and things. I'm going to need him, no? So let's be nice to him. That's already a too obvious plan. I'm not talking about this. We are talking just when you think that I'm doing a good deed to the public or to somebody that there's no chance ever to get back. For sure you will get back, because it doesn't come from him, it comes from Hashem. You have to understand, some people think everything is direct. I'm going to work in a store, and the store told me that they'll pay me $2,000 a month. That's the maximum I can make. That's my chance. I cannot make more than that. I'm all day in a store. So that's it. My maximum option is $2,000 a month. No, not true. A person that goes and finds a job, even though with this job there's no chance to be wealthy ever. Nobody ever almost become wealthy from this job. There's no chance. It's wrong, because the Jews are above the fortune, above the mazal. By a goy, 2,000 max from the store, that's what's going to come. By the Jew, Hashem say you only have to put an effort. Doesn't matter where. You want to be a teacher, teach kids, how much the parents going to pay you? $100 a day? It's not enough to pay for one kid of tuition for yeshiva. So what are you going to be? You're going to be a rabbi, you're not going to have what to eat. But it's a fact that all the rabbis in the world have a place to live. Most of them have a car. Most of them, their children in good yeshivot. Most of them marry their children. You know how many millions of dollars you need for what I just mentioned? Right? Health insurance, marrying the children, paying their tuition, have a house, have a car or two, have, you know, all the things, food for the family. Millions of dollars you need over the years. Millions. In America, millions of dollars. Especially with the marriages, because they have to give money for their kids to marry them. It's a lot of money. In the religious world, in Israel, it's a disaster, because each side has to commit to an apartment. And it's big. In America, they rent. In Israel, the mentality is not to rent, it's to buy. So right away, they have to buy, if they have 10 children, they have to buy 10 apartments, 10 halves, right there. A melamed in yeshiva that make $1,000 a month salary in Israel. That's what they make, if they're lucky. $1,000 a month. What is his chance to bring even enough food home? What is his chance ever to have a house, to own a car? What is his chance? There's no chance on the paper. Theoretically, there's no chance whatsoever. But Hashem shows us over the years, everybody will eat. You know, you don't get it from the work, from the job. All you have to do is to make an effort. Why? Why we have to make an effort? Because we're not in 100% level of emunah. We're not in a high level of confidence. If you have a very high level of confidence, even efforts you don't have to make. You don't have to worry. Everything will come to you if you have a high level of emunah. But since we are not in this level, we have to do something. To show Hashem, look, I'm doing something. It's very interesting, because the Torah says, Ki yevarechecha Hashem Elokecha bechol mishlach yadecha. Hashem is going to bless you in everything you are going to do. Which means you have to do something. I once told the story of one rabbi that they had to come to pick up, to collect money from wealthy people in America for his yeshiva. So, you know, he comes to Rav Chaim Kanievsky, and Rav Chaim Kanievsky, he said, Rabbi, it's the first time I go to America. I don't know, I never been there. I don't know anyone there. I don't know addresses and names of wealthy people. I really don't know anything. But I have to save my yeshiva. I'm in a deficit of $50,000. The debt accumulated and became already $50,000. My line of credit is finished. If I don't get in 2 weeks at least $50,000 and get the yeshiva back to zero balance, We are finished. I have to close the place. And I have many married guys. They have to get salaried on the first of the month. What am I going to do? It's a big responsibility. So I'm going to America. Hopefully Hashem will have mercy on me and I collect enough money. So Rav Chaim Kanievsky told him, I'm blessing you that you're going to be able to collect money, that you pay all your bills, and the yeshiva will stay. And he gives him all the necessary bracha. And he comes to America, the poor guy, he's not an expert in collecting money. So he comes to America. For 3 weeks he's here. He's going from one door to another, from one meeting to another, and nothing. In the end, he only paid for the ticket. That's it. Now, he only paid for the tickets after 3 weeks of going from one door to another. That's what he collected. Do you know what frustration we are talking about here? You come, you leave your family, you leave the yeshiva, you don't learn Torah, winter, summer, snow, going from one place to the other. Sometimes you're hungry for hours. You are sleeping in people's house, they go to work, you don't know where the light is, if you're allowed to open the fridge, you're going to have something to drink, where you can daven mincha, you're not in your place. It's a torture. So anyway, after 3 weeks, he's frustrated, he's coming back to Israel. You know, he's very, very upset. He goes to the yeshiva, he tells the gabbai there, we have a few days left, get ready, I don't know how to tell them. 2-3 days later, a messenger come, knock on his door. Rabbi, yes, I have a check from you from Rav Chaim Kanievsky. That's interesting. I only went to ask a bracha. It's not my friend. We hardly know each other. He opened the envelope, $50,000 check inside. $50,000. He runs right away, it's in Bnei Brak, few blocks, he runs to the rabbi. Rabbi, what a surprise. Where this money came from? I mean, who gave this? He said, one guy made a very big international deal. It was $500,000 profit. He calculated this 10% that he's obligated to give, maaser money. That's the, you have to give maaser, 10% from your net income. And he didn't know who he can trust. Who should he give the money to? He wanted to give it to Torah. So he came to ask my opinion. And the first thing came to my mind is you. So, here is the money. So he asked him, Rabbi, thank you very much. There's no words to describe how much I appreciate it. But I have a major question to you. If this check came from 2 blocks away from my yeshiva, 2 blocks away the guy lives. Why did I have to go to America for 3 weeks like a dog and run with food, without food, minyan, no minyan? Why? Why did I have to suffer so much? So Rav Chaim Kanievsky told him, if you wouldn't go to America, the check wouldn't come from Bnei Brak here. The check only came after you show Hashem how much you care about the Torah and about your students, and you're willing to leave your wife and your children and your Torah and be in the airport with all this goyim over there, with all this security, with, you know, it's not an atmosphere for a holy Jew to be in a place like this, with all these hippies and all these people and whatever going there in the airport. It's the biggest nightmare. How do you know if your soul's starting to become pure if you suffer in the airport? Not from the security, from the atmosphere in the airport. If you know, if you feel there that you suffer, then maybe you went one step higher. If you're not suffering in the airport, something is not right. Check yourself, I promise you. 100%. 100%. As soon as I see the airport from the outside, I feel like someone holding my heart and squeezing it. It's like a horrible feeling just to see this place, this what's going on over there with all the stores. Las Vegas, forget about it. It's hell. It's worse than hell. Somebody asks you, what do you prefer, to go to the airport in Las Vegas or to go to hell? Say to go to hell. You know what's going on over there? As soon as you come out of the plane, casinos in your face. All the cowboys with all the prostitutes, it's legal over there. You cannot open your eyes, you cannot look straight. It's big signs, flashy, everything. The Satan controls this place 100%. That's why when the destruction of United States will arrive one day, the first place will blow up in pieces, will be this place. There will be about 7 or 8 places that in 1 minute will explode and the rest will follow. Where are the places? San Francisco, run right away. The Village in Manhattan, right away. Las Vegas, right away. Miami Beach, right away. You know what you just told me? There's a lot of Jews over there. You're right, there's few synagogues there, a few good people. I've been there many times, but I want to tell you something. It's like a person that every one of his body organs is sick. His nose is okay, he's not broken. So you say, you know, his nose is not broken. But the eyes are blind, he's deaf, he has cancer here, cancer there, you know, he's crippled, he's whatever you just want. His kidneys have stones, what sickness he doesn't have? Okay, so his nose is straight, Baruch Hashem. He doesn't need a surgery. Yeah, there's few Jews there. Few Jews in Las Vegas, you know? Bottom line, the places that have more pritzut, they will be the first one who will pay the price. In Israel, you also have some places like this. It's not only here. Europe, Israel, there are places like this.
Las Vegas is 80,000.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. Not Israeli, Jews. 80,000 American Jews that they don't even know that they're Jewish. They already forgot about it. Yeah, I've been there a few times, I know. I'm telling you. They don't even remember they're Jewish. It's a good question. I still don't know how to define my job. What is it? They ask me sometimes, why are you coming to Canada for? Business, pleasure? I don't know what to say. What am I going to say? It's really a spiritual business. And they have some pleasure in it also. When you see people become religious, you have a great pleasure. You know, sometimes, like when I came back now from Montreal, I got an email from one very nice girl there. She said that she already spoke to 2 people from the seminar. One already became Shomer Shabbat, and one already now not eating not kosher food anymore. That's what she already found out a day after. Probably there's more achievements. So no, that makes you get a full energy. It's like a rechargeable battery, a real good one. Your battery charged for another month. Anyway, where were we? So the efforts that a person put, it shows Hashem how much you care. How much you care. If you see that you care, if you cry for your children, you show Hashem that you care about them, even though you're not the best father in the world, you're not a role model, you're not a rabbi, you didn't teach them what Ben Torah is, because you yourself is not like this. And sometimes you're not speaking clean, and sometimes you're going to a place you're not supposed to be, and you know, sometimes you're angry. You're not a perfect example. But if you show Hashem that your heart is broken with your children going to places they're not supposed to, and you care about it and you pray for it, then there's a bigger chance that He's going to hear you and to do some miracle for you. The next thing, your son's going to meet a good person, and he will invite him for Shabbat, and he will recommend him to come to his yeshiva. And the next thing you find, all of a sudden, a year later, your son is an angel. What happened? Wow, nobody believes. What's happening? The Gemara says, Rav Ashi, and this is in Masechet Sanhedrin Kuf Bet, Aya Doresh Barabim, he used to give lectures in public, in his yeshiva, about three kings that have no share to the world to come. They lost their share to the world to come. Who are the three kings? First one, Yerovam ben Navat. Yerovam ben Navat. Second one, Achav. Achav, the husband of Izebel. You know Izebel? It means she's garbage. Literally, that's what she is, but that's what it means. She's really, really, she used to be a very wicked woman. She persuaded her husband to murder an innocent person, to take his field. Very big story in the Torah, in the Tanakh. And the third one, he didn't get to speak about him yet. So he said to his student, tomorrow we will start the shiur speaking about Menashe, which is the third king that has no share to the world to come. Menashe. Okay, but he didn't speak about him yet. He spoke about Yerovam. He spoke about Achav. Tomorrow I'm going to speak about Menashe. In the middle of the night, guess who came to visit him? Menashe. See Menashe. Very angry. So you know, he knew that it's something to do with the shiur. So he told him in a dream, "How are you, my friend?" Like you go to the pizza store. "Como esta, amigo?" Don't even know his name. Jose. Carlos. Amigo. Every Spanish is amigo. Amigo, it's a friend. Muchacho. Flaco. Whatever. They have all kinds of cerveza. They like this word. Cerveza. Mucho cerveza. You don't know what cerveza is? Baruch Hashem, you're a kosher man. Drinks, beers, whiskey, cerveza. That's their gasoline. They don't know what water is. One of them told me once, I told him, "You want some water?" Say, "You're insulting me." I say, "Why?" He say, "Water is for women and flour." We drink cerveza here. Somebody just told me here before I came here, Yaniv, is a guy that gives out CDs here. He told me, you know, in America, don't be impressed that it says on a dollar, "In God we trust." You know what it stands for? What's God is? Huh? It's abbreviation of what? Huh? No, no, three words. The G, I'll give you a hint. The G is guns. Guns. Oh, what's O? Oil. And D, what's D? Huh? Drugs. What keeps this country going and being profitable, supposedly? It's three things that they make sure always to sell to the world and makes a lot of wars and problems. What is it? Guns. Oil, they want to always control the oil, they go here, they go there, and drugs. Drugs, you understand? That's what he says, and really it's interesting. In God we trust, because they don't really trust God. You don't see that they trust God so much. One day we'll give a lecture about trusting God. In the meantime, you can watch it in the internet. You have confidence in Hashem, part 1, 2, 3, and 4. It's a series in the website. Very recommended. Divineinformation.com. I know, very smart. It's good you ask. Like this, I publish it. Thanks to you. Thank you. Anyway, so Rav Ashi now has a visitor. His name is Menashe. Menashe, he said, "How are you, my friend?" Menashe said, "I'm not your friend and I'm not your father's friend." He's very upset. "How dare you calling me your friend? If you're already calling me your friend, I have a question to ask you," Menashe says. "When you make hamotzi on the bread, when you eat bread, when you make bracha hamotzi, where you cut the bread from? From what part of the bread?" So Rav Ashi didn't know the answer. So he told him, "I'm not sure." So he says to him, "You do not know where to cut the bread from, and you calling me my friend?" This is a king that put idols and worship idols all his life. It's not a joke. And he's angry at the holiest rabbi supposedly in his time. Rav Ashi, every page in the Gemara you have his name. Rav Ashi and Ravina. They wrote the Gemara, the Talmud. The Gemara that we have, they wrote everything. 400 years of halacha in the entire earth, they concluded by themselves with that computer. Everything from the head with no contradictions. All the subjects of the entire oral Torah, who against who, all the opinions, they set it up in the Talmud. Take a million Albert Einstein, not million, a billion Albert Einstein, put them in a convention for 1 year. to write one chapter in a Talmud that he won't have any contradiction and they will include all the opinions of thousands of rabbis. They will never do it. Nobody can do it. Definitely not in our time. So this is who we're talking here about. We're not talking about the rabbi of Tiberia. Talking very, very serious one. So he said, don't dare to call me your friend. You don't even know where to cut the bread from. So Rav Ashi started to get nervous. So he told him, if you're such knowledgeable person, how did you worship idols? So he told him, if you and your friends would be in my generation, you would pick up your kilt. They used to wear long kilts. You would pick up your kilts in the air and run the fastest you can to bow down to these idols. If you only knew how strong the desire to worship idols was in my time, you wouldn't dare to talk again about that. So the Gemara says, from this dream we learn something scary, shocking. You can never judge a person until you're going to be in his place. Sometimes we read in a book, this guy did this, this guy did that. Like Korach. Korach went against Moshe, what he did. One Rebbe used to remember his previous life. He remembered his Gilgulim. You know, the Ari HaKadosh was able to look at every person and know what bodies his soul was. By looking at the foreheads, he used to know. You come to him, in your previous life, you used to be Yitzchak. In the life before, you used to be Avner. In the life before, you used to be Mustafa. No, I'm joking. I'm joking. Anyway, so the Ari knew about every person. But that rabbi knew about himself. So he told his student, I have a sin. I remember that I was in a generation of Moshe Rabbeinu and Korach. So they asked him, who did you vote for? Did you go with Moshe or you went with the 250 rabbis that went against him? So he said, I was hiding in my tent the whole time. I didn't dare to come out. I was so afraid. So they told him, how is it possible? Wasn't it obvious to you that you have to go to the person that God spoke to? He told him, you don't know what's going on. If you hear the way Korach was speaking, it melts your heart. Moshe was stuttering. Everybody cannot understand what he says. He's stuttering. And he wasn't so charismatic like Korach. When Korach started to speak, he hypnotized everybody. What do you think? 250 chief rabbis joined him just like that? They all knew all the Torah. How to understand what's going on? We have no understanding who these people were. You read about them in the Torah, you think it's somebody from 5 years ago. We don't have an understanding. So anyway, so he told him, you would pick up your kilt and run to the idols. Run to the idols. You know, sometimes ignorant Jews that becoming religious, they just start to become religious. Five months, 1 year, 2 years. Especially those who don't go to learn Torah, how much they know? How much they know? 15 halachot, 100 halachot, how much they know already? They come 1 hour a day here and there, or they read a book here and there, and whatever they learn anyway, they forget after a month. So they don't know that much. They don't know that much. So this is a story that happened, that one Am Haaretz means ignorant. He lives across the street from an important rabbi in his town. And the rabbi, one Shabbat, the ignorant Jew see from his window that the rabbi made fire in his living room. Fire! Big fire! In a pan, in a tray. He said, what? They made fire on Shabbat? I have to go and scream and demonstrate over there. But it was a rainy day. So what did he do? He took his umbrella. He comes outside. He runs with his umbrella across the street. He comes inside. He closed the umbrella. He squeezed the umbrella to get rid of all the water. He put it on the side. He comes, Rabbi, fire on Shabbat. What's going on here? Didn't you read in the Torah, it says, "Lo tevaru ash b'chol moshvotechem"? I didn't expect from you such a thing. After he finished his speech, the rabbi told him, I don't understand why he's so excited. My daughter is giving birth as we speak. So we needed to put fire for her. The baby's coming out, it's winter, it's freezing, it's pikuach nefesh. It's not like today, you go to the hospital, the thermostat is 700 degrees. You cannot breathe over there from the heat. Well, over there, you know, the houses were not insulated good. It's freezing weather in Israel, in the north. Rainy day, windy. So you gotta put fire, if not the baby can die. It's not a joke. So they put fire. Pikuach nefesh. Torah says when there's a life risk, you're allowed to create fire and any other sin on Shabbat. So the rabbi told him, but let's now talk about you. From the minute you saw that I came to make fire for my daughter, that she and the baby will be safe, let's count how many sins you made on Shabbat. First thing, you did not judge me favorably. No, you know I'm a Shomer Shabbos. No, I'm not just another person from the street. All my life I kept Shabbat. So first mistake you did, you did not judge me favorably. Second mistake, you came out of your home with the umbrella. Don't you know there's no eruv here? You're not allowed to take any object from your house to the public territory. So that's a sin from the Torah, Chilul Shabbat. Then you open the umbrella, it's a sin from the Torah. You made a tent. You're not allowed to create a cover, a tent. Then when you came into my home, you closed the tent. So you broke the tent. And then you squeezed it. You're not allowed to squeeze. Five, and then the umbrella, to touch it, it's mukzeh. So you made five sins from the Torah and one sin from the Rabbanan, and you come to give me a speech? The poor, poor ignorant. So Rabbi, I don't know where to hide myself. So the rabbi told him, I'm not angry at you. I just want you to understand that there has to be a logic. Someone that is a beginner cannot make a beep and speak against anyone that is greater than him. Even by a little bit. You're not in his level, shh, don't talk. Don't talk. I cannot come and criticize doctors for the treatment that they gave somebody. Because I'm not, I don't know anything about medicine. A little bit I read articles here and there. Can I express my opinion? This surgeon is a fool. What's going on here? Why did he cut from here? Why did he cut from there? How do you know? Maybe there's nothing better to do. It's better to do something 50% than nothing, no? Sometimes a person comes out of a surgery half paralyzed. So everybody blames the doctor. How do you know? Maybe without the doctor he'll be dead. So now at least he understands, he functions. There's no way to know. So the conclusion is, what the Torah say, go and improve the way of your Jewish fellow, your Jewish brothers. It's not just like that as it sounds. First, you have to know how to do it. You cannot do it in public. You cannot embarrass them. You have to first know who you're talking to. Because if it's a person insecure, right away you will react in anger and in embarrassment. It can become worse. And also, you have to know if he's going to listen or not. Because it's a person with lots of ego. He will never accept from you. Never accept from you. It's not because of what you say, it's not true. It's because who says. You know, many of the people until this day, even in a religious world, they have a very bad habit. When they hear something, first thing, who say it? Who? If they tell them, no, just a student from the street, what does he know? Say, so, no, I was joking, it's the Rambam. The Rambam? Okay, no problem, so let's do it. Wow, what's the difference? If the new Baal Tshuva says something that is correct, and the Rambam say it, what's there's any different? The truth is the truth. You know, the Ashkenazi Sidurim, if I'm not mistaken, at least some of them, they start with a sentence that Bilam said. Bilam was a very bad goy. He wanted to curse the whole nation of Israel. His wife was his donkey, if you know what I mean. So that's a very filthy person. But he is the prophet of the Goyim. He is the prophet of the Goyim. So, what?
It's just something to do.
I know. So this, I'm trying to think what's the sentence is. Ma tovu alecha Yaakov, mishkenotecha Israel. That's what he says. He says a whole song, a whole. But a part of it he says, he's speaking positively about the nation of Israel. Ma tovu alecha, how great are the tents of the Jewish nation, you know, like bli ainara. Mishkanotecha Israel. So now he's praising the nation of Israel. What's so bad about it? So somebody asks, how can it be that from all the beautiful holy Torah that we have, and the prophets and the kings and everything, there's thousands of good words there. From everything, they chose to start the Jewish Siddur first thing in the morning from a filthy person and a filthy mouth that say this word? Say something for Moshe. Say something for Moshe. Ashir ala Hashem ki gamal alai. It's better, no? Odu la Hashem ki tov. We have enough great words from David HaMelech, the whole Tehillim, 150 chapters. So the answer is, why did they put this in the beginning of the Siddur? To teach us a very important thing. It doesn't matter who said, it matters what was said. You understand? Whether the Arab told it to you, whether the Christian, whether the Hindu, whether Bruce Lee, whether anybody. Even if your dog barked and told you something, or the parrot told you something, if the parrot is right, listen to him. It's very interesting, because did you ever know that there's one parrot in Israel that made two Jews Baalei Tshuva? You heard that or no? I have a friend, his name is Rabbi Yossi Valis. Who is Rabbi Yossi Valis? He's the chairman of Arachim organization. It's a big organization that make Baalei Tshuva mainly in Israel. So he had a parrot. One day the parrot disappeared. Somebody stole it, or he took him out to feed him and he flew. I don't know what's the story. He disappeared. Gone. A year later, somebody calls. He speaks to him to come to the seminar. So they begin to talk. So he said, what do you do? I have this, I have that. Somehow he got that he told him that he has a parrot. And he said that it's very interesting, because this parrot, you know, I found that parrot. And as soon as I brought him home, every Shabbat he screamed, Shabbat Shalom! Shabbat Shalom! So I'm not Shomer Shabbat, I get embarrassed from him. I come to light my cigarette, he screams, Shabbat Shalom! So Valis told him, wow, I also had a parrot like this, that used to scream this, and it's gone. What color he is, he doesn't remember. So the guy said, maybe it's your parrot. Can you describe him? Give me a sign. But he doesn't remember already signs. Maybe a year or two later. So he said, bring him with you. I think, maybe I changed the story, but the idea is just to get what happened here. Doesn't matter the details so much. So he said, bring him to the hotel, or bring him to my house. How do you know if he's my parrot or not? When I'm going to make my kids pass next to him, he's going to scream all their names. Whenever they come, he screams, Shimon! Avram! He recognized all of them. So he said, okay, that's a good sign. As soon as this parrot came, he saw all of them, he started to scream. But I think the first one, he forgot him. But from the second and on, he started to say all their names. So he said, you see, this parrot made me Shomer Shabbat. And these parents, apparently, I don't remember the whole story. They made a whole article in a religious newspaper about it. Two people already made religious. These parents. More than many Jews did. Huh? I wonder if they let the parrot go into a place that it's special for all the Mezakeh Arabim in Olam Haba. Just before we finish, and maybe you have some time for questions, Rabbi Anai had a tree in his backyard or in his front yard. And the tree every year grow wider and wider. And there is a wall around the house of Rabbi Anai, but the tree is so big and wide that most of his branches are going to the public territory, to the street. And Rabbi Anai is a judge in a Jewish court, in a Beit Din. One day, a bunch of people come to complain against one person in their neighborhood that is, the branches from his trees come to the public and it bothers them. Why it bothers you if you walk in the street and above you, I don't know, 10 feet above you, there's a tree? Why does it bother you? Because the old days people used to ride on a camel, remember? That's how it was. Horses, camels, so sometimes you put a lot of things on a camel, by the time you get to the tree, hop, you get stuck and falls. Right? Or the camel lost his eye or something. So now it bothers them. But Rabbi Anai, the reason he kept it like this, because he thought maybe the workers, they want shade to hide under. It's hot, very hot. Like this, they have a place to sit under. When they have lunch or something, they sit under the tree. So when he saw that they're complaining about it, the people, he got scared. He said, wow, I also have a tree like this. So he told them, I cannot judge the verdict today. Please come back tomorrow at the same time and I give you my answer. So they were surprised. Such an easy question. The rabbi cannot give the verdict now? Okay, let's come back tomorrow. The next day when he came back, in 1 second, he said, you have to cut your tree, they're right. So the guy smiling, Rabbi, with all due respect, Rabbi, don't you know that you have exactly the same tree like me and it goes also like a few feet to the public territory? So the rabbi told him, let's make a deal. If my tree is cut, you also cut yourself. If my tree is not cut, you don't have to cut. Fair deal? The guy was sure. How did he know? So he said, yeah, Rabbi, deal. It runs quickly, it cuts. So what do we learn from here? Before you come to tell another Jew, why you like this? Why you so angry? Why you so stingy? Why you don't do this? Why you don't this? Check yourself first. Probably you are worse than him. Check yourself first, be honest. Check yourself. You're giving him musar when you're worse than him. That's why when he finally wants to say something, you say, I'm telling musar to all of us, to me and to you. Not to you, to me. I'm talking to myself loud. And if you want to learn from my musar to myself, good enough. I'll be happy about it. That's basically what it is. If you have any questions about everything we spoke today, one last thing I want to mention. I know that, you know, one thing the Gemara says, that in order for a couple to have peace in a family, they have to, the husband has to supply the parnasa in a house. A husband that doesn't bring food at home, that's the beginning of the problems in a house. Person has to bring parnasa. It's very important to learn Torah, of course. You know, it's nice, very nice to trust Hashem. But if a person sees that he got married and he cannot bring food home, the marriage has problems. It's not a healthy house. But peace in a family, it's not only from food, that you don't have enough food or jewelry in a house. There are many, many different reasons that many houses do not have peace, and there's a lot of problems between couples and the children. There is a very good book that was written in this time by Rav Shalom Harush. Rav Shalom Harush is from Yerushalayim. He wrote, I think, 4 or 5 books in different topics, one of them about Emunah, and one of them about peace in the family, and few others. What's good about these books, that he take many difficult books that were written in the past, he combine all of them, and he takes the interesting things, and write it in a very easy way to understand, with nekudot, simple Hebrew, and he makes a very good job. He collects everything very nice. And somebody wants to know a lot about Emunah, he reads his book, Garden of Emunah. You have almost everything you need to know about Emunah. How it works, how the concept, how Hashem looks at you, what you're allowed to do, what you're not allowed to do, you know, the benefits of being a believer, and so on and so on. Same thing, English, Russian, Hebrew, they translate them to many languages, maybe even Spanish. But this is the book right here. This is in Russian, no? Хорошо, спасибо. What do you expect me to read it now? You come. So I'll leave you from here. If you have any questions after the presentation, okay, maybe we should first stay, the question first. Stay here.
I have this question. It's been bothering me for many, many years.
Yeah.
I took a class in Jewish history in Queens College.
Yeah.
And there was a conservative rabbi that was teaching it. You know, already people, even with the talent, you know.
I want to stop you right here. when you start the word conservative or reform, please do not say rabbi after that. Okay? It's like saying a Christian rabbi. Okay? Please, don't say Christian rabbi or a Muslim rabbi. Okay, no.
He goes to the whole class, he was basically on Jewish history, but he turned it around and he said how the Torah is actually not perfect. I know this is your specialty,
huh? Yeah.
So I think you're the perfect person to ask.
My answer to you is, before you finish your question, see this? Every honest person on earth that will watch this CD, I believe, and I see it all the time, should never ever have any more doubts that the Torah is divine, that God is watching us, that we have life after life, and the oral Torah is just as good as the written Torah, and it's also divine. And every question that we have about the free choice and about reward and about the punishment and how does it work, everything is in one DVD. And it costs us $1 to make. If you want to participate in this mitzvah, let me know. Even if you're not rich, doesn't matter. You donate 20, it goes to Jews, they become religious. Every mitzvah they do goes to your account for $10, for $20, for $100, for $1,000, whatever. Everyone according to his pocket. But you just know that the answer to everything is right in this DVD. It's 4 hours. It's talked about Mount Sinai, how do we know receive the Torah in public, what's the difference between Judaism to all the religions and cults, the purpose of life, many, many topics, everything in one DVD.
But you said something very strange, though.
Yeah.
That you were saying how in the Ashkenazi Sefer Torah,
yeah,
the Sephardi Sefer Torah,
yeah,
there's one letter, I think you know this, the
book. Suah Daka, yeah.
Huh? It bothered me, and I said to myself, Abba, how can this be?
Okay, let me answer you.
No,
it makes a difference. Let me answer you. We have something that's called Mesorah. You know what Mesorah? We have the Mesorah. There's ways how the Torah was transferred. It wasn't transferred randomly, coincidentally, everybody according to the way he wants. There's ways, there's rules, how everything was copied and transferred. We know, with no doubt, what's the original way to write it. It's the Yemenite way. The Yemenite way, because the Yemenite didn't move 2,600 years, they stay in the same place and ate jachnun. There's nothing else to eat, either melawach, jachnun, or fatut, it's all flour and water. It was very simple life. In the history of Yemen, you never had one Jew that is not Shomer Shabbos until this moment. In the history of Yemen, it never happened even once. In Yemen, but all the Yemenites that moved from Israel and came to Israel, they became dancers in a ballet, and the prisons are full of them. Why? Because the Zionists destroyed the Yemenites that came to Israel. They cut their peot, they took advantage on their goodness and their naivety. They were very naive because they didn't believe that there's such bad people in the world. You know, they never saw it. They were very humbled people. Very holy, most of them were learning Torah, it was very simple life, no materialism. They came to Israel, they cut their peos, they sent them to work on Shabbat. But in Yemen, nobody ever did. So they have the original way according to the Mesorah. We know it. So you might ask me why we don't change it. Because the rabbis don't have the guts to touch the Sefer Torah. Everyone is afraid. Why? Because in Judaism, we are very, very paranoid about even talking about changes. Why? Because we have such bad experiences from the reforms and from the conservative that brought so many tragedies to the Jewish nation. And the Holocaust happened because of them. All this movement of Haskala, millions of Jews died, and we continue to die spiritually, not only physically, because they modified the Torah. And they marry men to men, and they marry Jews to Goyim, and they eat pork, and they build the sukkah on Yom Shabbat, on Yom Tov. They build the sukkah with a drill. You understand? That's their Torah today. And even the Christians, I think, keeps more mitzvot than them. The Muslim, for sure. So you understand? That's why no one is there to make any even beep against we have to change. So we stay with this tradition, but when Mashiach comes, it will go back to the original. But it's only one letter. Remember, and the letter did not change the meaning of the word. That you should know. Okay, more questions, yeah.
Rabbi, you said that we're pretty close to Mashiach. there's a lot of people, even before generations before.
Yeah.
The Bible just time, we're even behind the Vegas, and saying,
yeah,
we're so close to Mashiach, and you keep saying it also.
But yeah.
How do we know when we're really, really close?
Everybody believed, it's a wishful thinking, you know. Everybody wants to hope that we are very close to Mashiach. But I don't speak based on feelings. I speak based on the signs that the Gemara gave. The Gemara gave signs of things that are going to happen in the world prior to the arrival of the Mashiach. Those signs, 50 years ago, none of them happened yet. None of them. In the last 50 years, all of them happened. So, in 2,000 years, none of these signs happened. So there was nothing that indicates that the Mashiach comes, besides the Jewish suffering in the pogrom and the problems. So Jews were hoping that Mashiach come and save us from all this misery. But really, there was nothing to back it up on, because the signs didn't happen. But today, all the signs happen. I have a whole lecture in the website. I actually have a CD in Hebrew. I never got to make it in English. The signs before the arrival of the Mashiach. I talk about it. The chutzpah that people have, what's going to happen in Israel, what's going to happen in the Knesset, what's going to happen in relationships in a family between the in-laws and the daughter-in-law. Things that are happening in our time that nobody even dreamed about 50 years ago. You have to understand, this was written 2,000 years ago. When the Chachamim wrote it in the Gemara, you know what it was like? What is it like? It's like you write today in a book that one day all the people will go like this with their hands and fly in space without any device, like this, and they fly. What's the chance? To write something like this in a book, you have to be a fool. Imagine 2,000 years later, all the people are flying. When Chazal wrote it about the prostitution and about all the things that has taken place today, and the prices and the inflation and all the things, nobody could even believe that something like this is possible. But today they all happen. That's why we believe more. Also, one more thing. Remember, until 50, 70 years ago, there was no weapon for mass destruction. If you wanted to kill a person, you have to put some powder in a gun and shoot. Today, the Vilna Gaon wrote that the last war will take 9 minutes. 250 years ago, he said it. People laugh. 9 minutes? The whole world? How can it be? Now today, you see many countries, just the United States, have almost 5,200 atomic bombs in all different sizes. It's enough to destroy the whole world in a minute, if they really want. So the idea is that there's enough weapon for mass destruction today to destroy the world in minutes. This is something that we didn't have in previous generations. So you see, everything is maturing for this moment, but we still do not know when it's going to be. It can happen in a month, it can happen in a week, it can happen in 5 years, it can happen in 50 years. There's no time limit. Most likely it will happen in our time, a very high chance. Not in our time, in our children's time. Not in their time, in their grandchildren's time, but we are very close to it. But definitely we're not allowed to put the finger on a date in a calendar and say for sure it's going to happen in that day. The Gemara is warning not to be a prophet, because we are not prophets. Yes. 2012? I have a whole lecture about it in my website. No, it's in English. Yeah, my website is 80% English. 80% English. So, yeah, so. We do not know if this Chilazon is reliable. We don't have Mesorah. The same thing, giraffe, right? Giraffe, it's kosher. But we don't know how to slaughter giraffe. Nobody wanted to get on a ladder and risk his life, because by the time you come, you stand on a ladder, maybe the giraffe will give you and you fall. So to eat giraffe would cost fortune, because the shochatim takes risk money. It's very dangerous. So over the years, we never slaughter the giraffe. We know it's kosher, but we don't know how to slaughter it. In what place on the neck? We do not know. You understand? So the same thing, the chelet of the tzitzit. We knew that we used to take it from a fish that called chilazon. And that fish has a special balloon inside its body. You make a hole with a needle and a blue blood comes out. And this blood, once you put it in a tzitzit, you can never ever erase it. Not with alcohol, not with trempentine, not with any chemo. There's no way to erase it. No way. Once you dyed something with that, that's it. Cannot erase it. So now they claim they found it. Maybe yes, maybe no. We don't have a Mesorah. We cannot. It's again, it's wishful thinking.
Like the Yemenites, you don't want
to change. We don't want to change. That's why we wait until Mashiach comes. He tells us what the Tchelet is. But 2012, I made a whole lecture about it. We do not care what the Goyim say. The Goyim never received the Torah from Hashem. Some of the Goyim are very smart. They know about medicine. They know about science. They know about many things. They know about art. Every nation has their talents. But that's not an indication that they have any information from God. They develop beautiful talents, the Goyim. Many nations, you know, they have in all kinds of fields. But we never found that the Goyim has anything that they receive from God. This 2012, it's a Mayan cult that used to be in South America, Mexico, Honduras, Venezuela, all these places, Indians. They have a calendar that ends at 2012. And they say that because it's ending, something tremendous is going to happen in the world. They never say a tragedy. They never say it's the end of the world. Today they make movies, they want to sell tickets. So they want to make people paranoid, the end of the world is coming. They never say that it could be something very positive. However, in my lecture when I was in Beverly Hills, about 6 months ago, something like that, I spoke about it and I said we have nothing to worry about what they say. And a few months later when I gave a lecture in Beit Gavriel with Rabbi Glazerson, if you remember, I gave a lecture with Chazak, so he was the guest speaker, Rav Matityahu Glazerson. He's an expert in codes, he writes many books. So I invited him, he also speaks good English, and he showed that according to the Torah, something great is going to happen in 2012. So now I got very nervous. I said, look, I went and made a whole lecture, baloney, don't worry about it, don't pay attention to the movies. All of a sudden, he comes and says that according to the Torah, something is happening. So now I understand why the lights, 7 times in the middle of the lecture, the power went off. Go into my website, watch what happened in that. Like, you never saw in your life such a thing. 7 times in 2 hours, the lights in the entire building went off and came back, went off, and I had a projector. So everything became dark. I had to speak when the building is all dark. Now I understand, because maybe Hashem is planning something for 2012. And I was telling the people to relax. It's 2012, it's called. Yeah, 2012. All right, any more questions before we go? Kadima, Rabbi Abbo, please. Thank you very much. And we'll see you next Wednesday, Bezrat Hashem.